I welcome everybody to this meeting of the Health and Wellbeing Board. Thank you for your attendance. Item one is the standard declaration of interest. If anybody wishes to declare any interest, can you please let us know soon?
Yes, I should declare this. I'm a chief department in rehab and practice, which may be relevant in the general practice item.
Okay, thank you, Phil.
Yes, because STP is on the agenda, I'm a governor of CVP, and because the OSCE report is also on the agenda, which I'm a member of the improvement board that is looking at the OSCE matters.
Very well, I am as well. I am. And so is Tony. And so is Tony. Yeah. So is Tony, me, and Phil, improvement board. And Annette. Okay, anymore? Chris?
Yes.
Sorry, Chris.
Yeah. Okay.
Item two, apologies for absence. Which is our local plan, and we own the business at this point.
middle office collaboration, and that's pretty much about what it says on the tin, really. So that's about becoming doing payroll systems across organisations more effectively, you know, being able to have sensible ways for organisations where to get back together to share our problems. And then finally, the fourth system is changing how we work together. So for example, our integrated commissioning approach in Wirral is very much backing up that, changing how we work together. It's how we utilise data, so the idea that we have, so we're developing a system of population health knowledge and management very much sits within that to enable us to develop a sustainable system. So I think it's fair to say that the local delivery services plan is quite well developed. It is developed from Healthy Wirral, which has been through here for more detailed conversations. And I think that what we will see is a close relationship around detail that's here through Healthy Wirral. I think what we haven't done as yet is developed a very clear framework of implementation of those local objectives. So I think the next stage is to try to figure out how they are going to be delivered and the framework that the Health and Wellbeing Board will have to have assurance that they are being delivered in the right way.
Okay, thanks very much. So can we note those comments? Okay, thank you. Item 6 is the A and E Delivery Board. Janelle, do you want to present this item, please? Thank you.
Against
the next steps. Recognising the agency interdependencies, it's really important that the agency leading the reward has a view of what services and the capacity of those services that support non-elected flows across the community. And that would include anything from primary care, community, secondary care, adult social care, and some of the services, the enablement services that are delivered through the Better Care Fund. And that we need to develop some performance KPIs and improvement KPIs for those the commission services. What's also important is that where services need to change or there's a decision made to decommission services or there's an unplanned loss of service, which we've recognised more recently, that we need to have an overview of that to help accommodate. And that the reporting that would go through to the any leader of the board and then up through to the Earl and West Cheshire any leader of the board. So the recommendations from the paper were to for you to note the progress today on the establishment of the leader of the board, give any feedback in terms of reference, recognise the interdependencies of all health economy partners to the reliable delivery of the 4-hour standard. Understand that the new national escalation system actions may result in resource implications for providers and include rural leading delivery board updates as standing item on health and wellbeing.
Okay, thanks very much. So, comments on this? Graham?
I want to make helpful comments as opposed to ask a question. And I think the helpful comment I want to make is why is this so important? And the issue is that. 4-hour targeting itself is something that's very, very important to government. The reason it's important to government is that people who aren't dealt with through an A&E 4 hours, evidence shows that their outcomes are really important. So if people aren't dealt with within that period of time, then often they will die or their outcomes will be much worse than they would have been. So this is a call nationally for us to absolutely get our act together. In terms of making sure people aren't waiting in ambulances outside of A&E, that people aren't waiting on trolleys and corridors and all of those sorts of things. So it is really important to get this right across the system. The challenge is there are no extra resources for any of us to deal with this, and the system's under a lot of pressure. But we have to do the right thing. So everybody's working like mad to get this as right as they can. So I just want to say that comment because we all recognise how important it is, but there are no resources.
Okay, thanks, Greg. Phil?
I get stuck because I'm a layman, and I'm trying to do with a bit of help. I'm really looking at what's there was page 12 or page 11 of 40, because the numbering is quite different. And the two key actions there, which I can refer to, where we've got general practice and emergency departments have got immediate telephone access to discuss urgent referrals for senior doctors. And partway down, processes should be in place to enable patients requiring urgent specialist assessment to be streamed directly to an appropriate assessment unit. Now, those imply, putting it as discreetly as I can, that there is space or room or availability of staff to do that work and some of those patients to be directly admitted to bypassing A&E. But the obverse, converse, whatever the word you want of that, is the issue of improved discharges. So you can't put more people in quickly bypassing A&E unless we've got relevant places, placements and services for people to come out to if there's pressure to put them out because there's people coming in. I hope I explained that well in my layman's terms, and it's the two sides of that working together that I think I need to appreciate.
So you've hit the nail on the head. I think those two things are intrinsically linked. This particular
So they're listed. I perhaps we just have a bit more detail so I can understand what that's about.
Yeah, so the rapid improvement guidance that you just looked at, we had to assess, do a self-assessment against those standards to say whether we were red, which means we had nothing in place, whether we were amber, which meant we had plans but those hadn't delivered, green, etc. So we assessed ourselves as a health economy against each of those standards. And where those standards were either red or amber, then we needed to provide a detailed action plan as to how we were going to get where we needed to be. From a discharge perspective, a couple of pieces of work that we've got ongoing, which is first home, so this is a discharge to assess model, so a patient, a discharge home for their assessment valiant being assessed to be discharged. We've got a pilot that went live on the 7th of November for 5 patients who were taken out and we managed their home in that way. If we recognise that that works, then we'll scale that up really, really quickly. We've also commissioned some discharge to assess bedded function with a local care provider as well. So we have got, again, lots of work going on around discharge and assessing patients in their own home or out of hospital, which is best practice.
Philip, if I can just add a little bit, because I think it is really important to put this into a whole systems context, which is what Janelle has been trying to describe. But from community and social care and hospital perspective, we've always got three pieces of work that we've been looking at. So we need to do, and we're in the middle of creating an avoidance service so that all the patients who previously would have been assessed at the hospital, we've got other opportunities in the community. So we've got a rapid community service that will be able to assess people in their own homes and step up to intermediate care beds if appropriate instead of going to hospital. We're also trying to make sure that we've got a number of signpost interventions or we've got triage as well as assessment within that single point of access, which is outside of the hospital. And we need to build up that resource and expertise. And that is in conjunction with primary care. The hospital have got their internal pieces of work that they're doing. And then we've also got work that we're doing again across the system around the discharge process, which Janelle has described. So I think it's really important that we all understand that actually it's in all of our interests to get all of those different parts of that whole pathway correct, and that we all have a responsibility to make sure that the patients do get into the right part of the system. Because we all know, particularly with our elderly population, if we get into hospital and stay in hospital too long, then that's a good problem. And we could end up being really deconditioned and end up in really expensive care packages and parts of our system, which isn't right for all their families. So we're all very, very keen that we work together across that system to ensure that everybody gets that right level of care at the right time. And all that is wrapped up in making sure you get a 4-hour wait right. But there's a whole host of pieces of work which is now quite described. But I wanted to reinforce that we're doing this as a whole system to make that better.
Okay.
Thanks. Part of what I wanted to say about is just elucidated in terms of being aware of a stay in hospital of anything more than 48 hours, so even 72 hours, there's a significant deconditioning effect on the frail or elderly in particular. But also, I think it's important to get this right clinically because I don't want there to be feel Graham is absolutely correct that there is clinical evidence that waiting more than 4 hours in ED makes your outcome, clinical outcome worse. But I absolutely don't want anyone to go away with the thought that because of that, we're trying to rush people through and have them out when it's not the right thing for them. So I say, from the point of view of deconditioning, the sooner you're home, the better for your health. But also, there's a myth, really, that being in hospital is good for you. It's not good for you in terms of the deconditioning, but we also want to be aware of however good hygiene is. There are more better for you to be out in your in the community or in your own home, whatever's appropriate, as soon as you are medically fit to be so.
Okay, any more? Chris?
Can I just follow the and how that's going to work, because I think a lot of people do turn up to A&E because they can't get an appointment with their GP, and I know because GP surgeries are so busy. So how is that going to work? Can you just elaborate a little bit more about that?
So we're working with Dr. Paul Cowan on how we do exactly that, which is get urgent access back to GP practices. And there are a number of ways that we can do that, and
So can I ask you to turn to the recommendations on page 3 then? Are we happy to agree those recommendations?
Yeah.
Yes? Okay, that's agreed. Thank you very much. Okay, so that then takes us on to item 7, which is the Ofsted report. Julie, you want to do a presentation?
But before I do that, I just want to set the work of Children's Services, which is a partnership endeavour from the beginning, middle to the end, in the partnership with the context of the meeting this afternoon. So I want to tell you a little bit about the vision for getting really good outcomes for children in Wirral. So our vision is that children will be happy, safe and achieving, and we want only the best for our children. So, three slides. I'm going to just describe three key components of our overall strategy. Firstly, we want to intervene early in children's lives, when problems first start to appear. So as Janelle talked about, the right service at the right time in the right place, that applies as much to children and families as to maybe children, families or adults turning up at A&E services. So we want to work with our local communities, we want to engage with children and families as soon as challenges and problems first begin to present, so that we intervene and provide services to stop those challenges becoming and escalating into crises. And it's through working together with partners that we'll streamline access earlier to services when children and families need them. Thus preventing as many children and young people needing more acute services, which is what is happening at the moment. Secondly, we want to make sure that the plans for children are really tight and focused on delivering good outcomes. So we want better understanding with partners about how we work together. We understand the level of support that children and families need, so collectively we can intervene and provide that support when they need it. One of the big things we need to do in Wirral is feel confident in supporting more children and young people at home with their families, and collectively managing those risks where it's safe to do so, with children remaining longer than in their childhood at home. When children do need to become looked after, we want to make sure as many children as possible remain in Wirral, in their own communities, going to local schools, receiving local health services and facilities in their local community where they're rooted and they belong. And we want to make sure that any placements children need, any care placements, pass the test of being good enough facilities that you'd want for your own children. So that's the standard test that we need to apply. And we need to make sure that care isn't a situation that children stay in. They're either supported if safe to return home after a brief period in local authority care, or supported to achieve permanence through adoption or something called special guardianship through the courts. And to do all of this, we need a strong, experienced and permanent workforce. This focuses a little bit, first part, on social workers. And we're saying we need a really strong, excellent environment where good social work will flourish. I'll just read this little bit out. These are a conference of directors of children's services recently, and going through a number of different sessions, talking with a number of different colleagues nationally, trying to distill what are the core components that would enable excellent social work to flourish. So some of the areas are having clear practice standards, making sure that social workers have manageable caseloads, making sure there's appropriate practical support for social workers. Little things such as their office environment is right, they've got access to good IT systems, they can park, all those facilities, practical things that sometimes people overlook. Making sure that social workers work with an evidence-based model as an underpinning approach to how they do their social work business. And social workers operate in small enough teams where the managers know not only the workers well, but the manager knows the families that the social workers are engaged with. And there's an operational culture of reflective thinking, of feedback, of learning and support. So that's the right kind of very ingredients of what makes a really good social work team office, enabling the best really think what it's like to be in their circumstances when determining how to provide support. And develop plans collectively on the basis of thinking that plans are promises to do something, and getting the plans that are focused on delivering actions which achieve good outcomes, that pass what I call the so what test, not just plans for plans' sake. And that the whole environment in which we work with is one of openness and transparency, where everyone's accountable for doing the best. A number of people have said to me after the Ofsted inspection, who's to blame? Is it the social workers we point the fingers out because they're not doing the job properly? And I've steadfastly said, I am not blaming social workers. It's not social workers won't be getting out of bed to do a bad job in the morning. But what they need is the right environment, and there's more we need to do. We need to make sure it's a very open and transparent environment where there's nowhere to hide, so the practice is very clear, we know exactly what's going on, but within that we have standards and hold people to account. So that's the overall framework. Just a little bit about Ofsted. Ofsted came and did their inspection of safeguarding in July of this year. The inspection was 4 weeks, a grueling process. For the last 2 weeks of the inspection, we had between 12 and 13 inspectors on site each day, for 3 days each week. And they basically had the keys to the electronic filing cabinet, and they could look at any child's case during that period. So it was a root and branch review. And if they got a hunch or an inkling about something they were not confident about, they would follow that through and look at lots of children's cases. And in total, they looked at about over 1,000 pieces of information on separate children during that process. The overall judgment was inadequate for the overall safeguarding inspection, and that was the overall judgment, a separate judgment for a simultaneous inspection of the safeguarding board. And within the overall judgment of safeguarding, there were two areas that got a judgment that requires improvement, and they were services for children looked after and also care, also adoption. So the Ofsted have come up with 26 recommendations across the core service, and which includes 7 recommendations for the safeguarding board. And the recommendations are things around social workers doing high quality assessments, recommendations about risk management, recommendations about taking account of children's history when developing plans for children, recommendations about having better services to support children's emotional health and well-being, a significant recommendation for partners about making sure, firstly, we spot signs of concern for children, and there's a consistent understanding of when people should be worried about a child, but then as well as that, an understanding of what we call thresholds, so people are clear about what service is the right level of service to provide for a child. We did a piece of work yesterday with our multi-agency safeguarding board, where members of the board were asked to say what they thought constituted significant harm for a child, because they're the children who need a social work intervention. And it was a really good workshop as people teased that out. And that's the basis for a piece of multidisciplinary work we're going to carry on over the next couple of months, to make sure people really understand what to do. Because one of the key issues in the Ofsted inspection was that where children were found to have experienced a single event, such as a child acutely harmed, for example, with a fractured skull, the system worked extremely efficiently. Police and health, the local authority, knew what to do. That child was safeguarded effectively. Where children were living in situations where perhaps there was chronic neglect, and there wasn't a single incident, but a cumulative impact of those concerns, the level of support was less likely to meet the level of vulnerability. And that's the area we need to work on across the partnership to better understand if that makes sense. In terms of the safeguarding board, some of the recommendations were about that board being more challenging, that board always having accurate performance data, which is a theme throughout the whole inspection, and making sure that everyone was held to account and partners fully understood and understand what their role is in providing safeguarding services. So what we've done is tried to separate, there's lots of kind of individual specific recommendations. We tried to group them into three headings. So they are people, practice and performance. So I'll just briefly take you through these three headings before telling you a little bit about what we've done so far, and then also the relevance of this, which I hope you will pick it up for the Health and Wellbeing Board. So in terms of leadership, terms of people, there are three key areas in respect to this. So firstly, leadership. The first recommendation in the Ofsted report is that we need to recruit an experienced, permanent, effective, and consistent level of service for children in social care. It's been a post where we've seen a lot of change over the last 3 or 4 years. And we've gone out to advert for a newly graded deputy director post. We're absolutely crystal clear about the calibre of person we need to recruit in the authority to lead children's social care. We need to recruit many more experienced social workers. We've got quite a lot of sessional or agency social workers in the authority, and that leads to retention. Every time a social worker leaves, if you can imagine being a child who's experienced a great deal of trauma, the social worker says, tell me about your family, tell me about what's troubling you. And if you imagine, think about yourself for a minute, sharing some intensely difficult, challenging personal information. And then that worker just leaves. Then you get another one who says, tell me all about your background and your family. Doing that 6 times in 6 months. Children genuinely say to us, why do I bother? I'm not saying that again. I feel betrayed, I feel awkward, I feel it's not worth it, I feel people think I'm rubbish. So it's absolutely imperative that we secure permanent workers who will stay and work with the authority and provide that lasting, trusting relationship to children. I've just interspersed some of the slides with some of the things that children tell us, because if you really listen to some of our more vulnerable children, and I think this applies to all children, I continue to be blown away by how direct children are and will tell you what needs to happen. Our children tell us that these are children perhaps who are in care as a local authority or receiving services. They want social workers to understand their personal care, perhaps have more mental health training. They say, don't patronise us, be respectful to us, look at my life story, don't just respond to my symptoms. This point about retention, they want consistency with professionals working with them. Don't stop working with me when I don't communicate, kind of reach into me and find different ways of engaging me. That's probably when I'm feeling most troubled. Stick with me and don't give up on me, and actions, not just words. This is all that we need to embody in these frontline workers and managers engaged with our vulnerable children. In terms of practice, we need to invest in and improve training, making it really clear with partners and social workers and managers from every discipline what good looks like, so that everybody's got a set of standards and we're applying those at all times. Senior and middle managers have